The Little Book of Feminism by Harriet Dyer, read by Katie Bennett.
Feminism is defined as the advocacy of women's rights on the ground of equality for the sexes. Introduction. This doesn't always mean the same thing to everyone, and that's not surprising given that women make up half the population of the world. What is a feminist issue for one culture might not apply to another. Given the vast scope of all of human history and every country in the world, it would be impossible to try and fit everything into a 96-page book, even if the writing was very small. Instead, I have chosen to give a brief outline of the history and causes of Western feminism, found mainly in the UK, mainland Europe, and the US, concentrating specifically on the laws of the UK. Consider this a brief portrayal of what feminism has looked like throughout the years, the context of the issues feminists have focused on, and what they have achieved. There may be times in your life when, as a woman, you may have felt put at a disadvantage or treated unequally and have been unable to put into words quite how or why you felt like that. I hope to demonstrate not only how far we've come, but also how far we still have to go in order to achieve true equality and point out the issues, subtle and not so subtle, still faced by women today. Statistics. The gender pay gap for people in full-time work in the UK is 10%, and in the US it is 21%. Around 70% of people working minimum wage jobs are women. Only 17% of board directors of the FTSE 100 companies and 4.6% of Fortune 500 companies are women. Only 1 in 4 MPs is a woman, and women from minority ethnic groups make up only 1.2% of MPs, yet comprise 4% of the UK population. Just 23% of reporters on national daily newspapers in the UK and 37% in the US are women. In the US, 85% of domestic abuse victims are women, and 1/3 of female homicide victims are killed by intimate partners. Around 85,000 women in the UK and 293,000 women in the US are sexually assaulted each year. At least 75% of mothers have primary responsibility for childcare in the home. Almost 1 in 3 girls has experienced unwanted sexual touching at school. 1 in 4 women in Britain will experience domestic violence in her lifetime. Sources: Violence Policy Centre, Bureau of Justice Statistics, National Institute of Justice, Centre for American Progress, UK Feminista, and Refuge UK. First Wave Feminism. Introduction. Question: when is a feminist not a feminist? Answer: when she is a first wave feminist. First wave feminism is the umbrella term retrospectively applied to the women's rights movement, originating in the West in the mid-19th century. However, if you found yourself in the middle of a Langham Place Circle meeting in the 1850s and talked about the feminist cause, you'd get some pretty blank looks, not least for your extraordinary behaviour. The word feminist wasn't in use in Britain until the 1890s. You might get a similar reaction for bandying around the word suffragette. Although almost interchangeable with the term first wave feminist now, the term suffragette was first used as an insult in 1906 in the Daily Mail, a patronisingly feminine twist on the word suffragist, at the time a campaigner for the right to vote. So, if first wave feminists didn't know they were feminists and weren't all suffragists or suffragettes, what were they? What did they want? And what were they for? The women's rights movement largely consisted of separate groups and independent campaigners working toward improving the rights of women. Although different groups were campaigning for different causes, the main focus was on improving laws and legislation to give women a more equal footing with men. This included better education opportunities, access to certain professions, equal rights in employment, the right to control their own money and property, and, of course, the right to vote. For example, the Langham Place Circle campaigned to help women enter the workplace, funding their training through the unfortunately named SPEW, the Society for Promoting the Employment of Women, and endeavouring to reduce the social stigma around middle-class women working instead of relying on fathers, brothers, and husbands for money. The mid-1800s to the early 1900s saw much change in legislation and women's circumstances. Boiling point. In Great Britain in the mid-19th century, women did not have the right to vote, could not as easily divorce their spouses as men could, did not have the right of custody of their children over 7 years old, did not have the right to own property if married, could not attend university, could only enter certain professions, and, when they were employed, were not afforded equal pay or rights. The law worked in many ways to ensure women's dependence on men. Such inequality was hardly new for the female population, but by the 1860s, conditions were ripe for women to start calling for a better life. A lot of things were changing in British society. By the mid-19th century, the great wave of fresh philosophical thought of the 18th century Enlightenment period had provided fertile ground for a drive towards social change throughout society, and in 1792, Mary Wollstonecraft published A Vindication of the Rights of Women. Men were calling for universal suffrage, the right for all people, or in this case, men, to vote, regardless of personal wealth or status. By the 1830s, slavery had been abolished in Britain, and the Chartist movement was fighting for the improvement of working-class political rights. Slowly but surely, society's opinions were changing. There wasn't just philosophical change in the air. In the mid-1800s, the Industrial Revolution was well underway. A leap forward in technology meant a significant change in the lives of working people. Families moved away from the countryside and into the cities for work, changing the typical household setup known until then. New technology meant that work that used to be performed by skilled workers could now be completed by machines, with factories springing up around the country. Skilled male workers wanted to hold on to their ways of working, fearing they'd be pushed out of the market by automated processes and machines, so withheld their skilled labour from factory owners. These owners, wanting to utilise new machines to maximise profit, consequently hired unskilled women and children to feed the demand for labour. Working class women found that they worked in similar jobs to men, providing for their families as men.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.